إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في الكتاب الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. وقال عز وجل: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O human beings, O mankind, be conscious of your Lord who created all of you from one person. And from that one person he created his mate, and from the two of them he created many men and many women. All of you have one source. And so be aware of Allah, be afraid of Allah in the way you treat each other. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, be conscious of Allah, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَأَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ. Be conscious of Allah through whose name you ask each other for your rights. And be conscious of the ties of kinship. إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. Definitely, without a doubt, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over you. He's listening to you. He's aware of everything that you're doing. يا أيها الذين آمنوا, O people of Iman, اتقوا الله, be conscious of Allah, be aware of Allah. حق تقاته, the way Allah deserves. It's the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you should be thinking about Allah throughout your day-to-day business, throughout every moment that you spend. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to be in your mind. And if you forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you destroy yourself. And so be conscious of Allah, be aware of Allah, and have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. حق تقاته, the way He deserves. وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. And don't you dare die except in a state of Islam. And we're all going to go. This world is going to end. And so the whole purpose of this creation is for us to come here and come back to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a good state. And so the scholars have said that the human being, the way that we are, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the human being in such a way that the iman that we have, the awareness that we have, the consciousness that we have, it's always flipping this way and that way. And the Prophet ﷺ described it, he said, the heart is like a feather. It goes in the desert and the wind comes, takes it this way and that way. So there's always, your states are changing. The way you are is always changing. You're not all the time feeling the same way. Some days you feel awesome. MashaAllah, you get up for Fajr and you do extra dhikr, you pray extra prayers, you read more Quran than usual, and you give in sadaqah and doing a lot of good things. Other days, na'udhu billah, you're in places you're not supposed to be, you're saying things you're not supposed to say, anger is taking over, and so we're in different states. And the Prophet ﷺ said, this is the nature of Iman. Sometimes it's up, sometimes it's down. And if you are always in a good state, the Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, you will see the angels come down and greet you in the street. But the nature of our Iman is, we're not always in the same level. It's always changing. And so, when it's going down and you find yourself in a bad state, the scholars have said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us tools to come back to Him. And this tool is tawbah. You come back and you start returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by seeking forgiveness, by coming back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's remembrance, by admonishing yourself, what I did was wrong. This is not right the way I am, it's not correct. And you start to struggle against yourself. And this struggle, the scholars have said, beware, sometimes a bad deed could be the cause that leads you to Jannah. And it is better to have a bad deed that makes you humble before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making you want to seek forgiveness, making you want to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shedding tears in nighttime. Ya Allah, fix me. Ya Allah, help me. That bad deed is better in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than somebody who does a good deed that leads to spiritual arrogance and puffed up pride. And so the scholars have said that just as our nature has these different aspects, the world around you has these different things. But as believers, when we look at the Quran, when we start to interpret events, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He is in charge of everything that happens. We believe in Tawheed.
Tawheed doesn't just mean you believe in the oneness of Allah. It means you believe that everything that's taking place in the world, it is the action of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything that's happening, the good that's in your life, the bad that's in your life, all of it is being manifested by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all of it is coming to you as a test. And so some people, they look at these tests, the difficulties, whether it's inside themselves, whether it's outside, people that's giving them hard time, or the difficulty they find themselves in their life situation with rizq and this and that. And sometimes they get into this manic states. They get into depression. They get into, you know, they become upset. And their life becomes like a tragedy. And subhanAllah, if you look at Western literature, all of the Western literature, all of it starts to stem from tragic stories. You know, in the end, everybody dies. But if you look at the Quranic worldview, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that everything has a happy ending. Especially if you're on the good side, if you're on the side of good, no matter what you're going through, the end is going to be happy. The end is going to be good. Even if you die in the end. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, قُتِلَ أَصْحَابُ الْأُخْدُودِ النار ذات الوقود إذ هم عليها شعود وهم على ما يفعلون بالمؤمنين شهود. وما نقموا منهم إلا يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحكيم. Allah subhanahu describing the situation. Believers are being lined up. They're thrown, being thrown into ditches filled with fire. And then at the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذلك هو الفوز الكبير. These guys, they got the greatest victory. What victory? You walk into the fire, you end up in Jannah. Right? You walk into this profound difficulty, but on the other side you find out it was Jannah. So you have this kind of ending where it looks like it's bad on the surface, but it's really good. And then the other ending is people, the anbiya that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent, Musa alayhi salam, that comes, and this is the day of Ashura, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered Medina. He found the Jews fasting. He said, why are you fasting? They said, this is the day Allah gave us victory. This is the day the sea split open and we crossed the sea and we watched Fir'aun drown in front of our eyes. This is the day of victory. And so what happened? The Prophet ﷺ said, you know, Musa is closer to us than he is to them. So we should also fast this day. But he said, don't follow their way. Don't be like them. So if they fast one day, you fast 2 days. And so we're fasting this day to celebrate what? The day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us victory. But just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us in the creation that you have within yourself opposites. Some days you're excellent, some days you're horrible. Just like that, you have that same things in the creation. And the same day after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you have the day of Ashura, where the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Imam Hussein, and his family are massacred in the field of Karbala. And then this was a great tragedy in our ummah. You know, they say Karbala. Karb means what? Disaster, calamity. Bala means the same thing. So this was disaster upon disaster that hit this ummah. And so when you look back at history, what do you celebrate? What do you highlight? Do you highlight the tragedy or do you highlight the success? And the Prophet ﷺ, he had tragedies happen in his life. His uncle Hamza was killed and mutilated, and they came and they even ate from his body and his liver. But the Prophet ﷺ didn't celebrate this day of mourning every single year. This is the day my uncle died. He didn't do that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So his worldview, his mentality was, you celebrate the positives in life. And so that comes from recognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That comes with understanding the reality of this world. We are living in hayat al-dunya. This is the lowest existence. And so, if you want to seek happiness in dunya, the scholars have said that, know that you will find yourself bouncing between this and that all the time. Sometimes you're good, sometimes you're bad. Sometimes you're good, sometimes you're bad. In terms of your livelihood, in terms of your health, in terms of your iman, everything is like this. And so if you're looking for happiness in this world, the scholars have said, no, you will not find happiness in this world. Forget it. People seek for it in different ways. You know, I want to make more money. Why do you want to make more money? You probe them, ask them, why do you want more money? What's that going to do for you? Because if I have more money, I can do more things. Why do you want to do more things? If I can do more things, I can have a house, I can have a car. Why? So I can be happy. Comes down to that point. Somebody goes and robs a bank. Why did you rob a bank? So I can be happy. At the bottom of this is this. Somebody goes seeking knowledge. Why are you seeking this? So I can find this contentment, this happiness. Everybody's looking for the same thing. And the scholars have said, if you're looking for it in dunya, you will not find it. Why? Because if you gain anything, there's a possibility of you losing it. Today you're healthy, mashallah, alhamdulillah, everything's good. Tomorrow you can lose your health. You know, an athlete with strong heart, running, could drop dead. This is the nature of this dunya. So what can you get from this dunya? Nothing that will make you satisfied eternally. Except turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the scholars, they said, you are here to be on a spiritual path. Your purpose in this dunya, to get on the spiritual journey. And the beginning of this journey is tawbah. That's the beginning. And said, one of the scholars said, and don't stop at the beginning where you're sinning and making tawbah, sinning and making tawbah. That's like this rat that's running in circles. You know, you're always flipping this coin. You don't know in which one of these states you're going to die. If you're always at that edge, you're sinking to disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're coming back. You're sinking to disobedience, you're coming back. If you die, you don't know in which one of these states you're going to die. You're either going to die disobeying Allah or you're going to die making tawbah. But better to start on this journey and start moving forward. Instead of taking one step forward, one step back, one step forward, one step back, start making progress in your religion. Start learning the ahkam of the religion. Start learning the qawaid of the religion. Know what is required from you as Muslims. Know what is required from you. What does Allah want from you? What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ask you to do? Because all of us have a state of takleef. The scholars have said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us all of these different responsibilities. So you are responsible merely by the fact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you responsible. And the only ones exempt from this responsibility are children that haven't yet reached the age of maturity, or people that doesn't have a rational capacity, or people that are, you know, I forgot the third one.
Crazy.
They've lost their mind. So you have responsibility before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this responsibility takes the higher concern. And so, for fulfilling this responsibility will bring you goodness. But you know, sometimes we are excellent at deluding ourselves. People are excellent at self-deception. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this in the Quran. Ghurur, you know, the deception that people get into. And now psychologists are discovering, subconsciously, somebody could be completely in the wrong. And they know they're in the wrong, deep down inside. But they can come up with 50 different justifications for what they're doing. They can, you know, and what it takes for them to admit finally they're wrong is the fire of hellfire. You don't want to wait for that to happen. And there are people who get into business arguments with each other. Right? This was my share. No, this was my share. And they're fighting and this and that. And one person knows he's in the wrong. But you know what? He's got this clever mind. He can come up with different ways to explain and cheat the other person. And they're doing this baghawat, as they call it in Urdu. They're reaching for somebody else's money. They're reaching for somebody else's wealth. And they're eating another person's wealth unjustly. And they know what they're doing. They can justify it all they want. In front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can't. And so, stop doing that. And earn halal income. It makes no sense you eat halal chicken and earn haram income. What does that mean? You go and make wudu in the neighbor's backyard with the water because water bill's going up? That makes no sense. And so the first thing is purification of yourself internally, purification of your wealth. And when you have these two things straight, one of the scholars has said there is no barakah in anything except good food and righteous company. There's no barakah in anything except food and righteous company. What does this mean? The food that you eat, it's not just the food you put in your mouth. It's the way you earn your income. And righteous company is keeping people that will remind you about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the starting of this journey is you start with tawbah and you start to purify yourself. And you walk with purification of your wealth and purification of yourself by keeping righteous company. And slowly, slowly, your bad deeds become finer and finer and finer. As one of the scholars said, Hasanatul Abrar Sayyatul Muqarrabin. That means people that are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their bad deeds are like the good deeds of righteous people who are in the beginning of this journey. And so you can get to a level where your bad deeds become so fine, so minute, that a person who's just starting on this journey will consider your bad deeds to be his good deeds. And that's the purpose, is you have to be improving day by day by day in your religion. Otherwise, what are we doing here? What's the purpose of this life? Is it just to eat, drink, go to sleep, get back to work on Monday morning? Is this everything we're here to do? Or sit down and watch TV show after TV show after TV show? Is that why you're created? You know, so we have to realize we have serious responsibility. At the same time, you know, one of the scholars said the nafs loves extremism in everything, in guidance and in misguidance. The nafs does not want to be moderate in guidance or misguidance. So what happens? Somebody might make tawbah and they go crazy, right? Suddenly everybody's against them. Why? Because this guy is the most miserable person to be around, because suddenly he's become religious. Don't go to that extreme either. And the other extreme, a lot of people don't consider this to be extremism, but when you're sitting down watching TV show after TV show after TV show, completely neglecting your responsibilities with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's an extremism also. You're extreme in not caring about what happens to you. And so we have to come back to the balance. We have to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَقُولِ قَوْلِ هَذَا أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد. And so, final piece of advice is, of course, we are here in this world, we have this mission, we have these responsibilities that we have to fulfill. At the same time, there's always going to be a pushback against you. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you have enemies. You have enemies. And some of them are amongst people, some of them are amongst the unseen realms. You don't see them. But they're surrounding you, they're whispering in your mind, middle of the night, you wake up with your blood boiling because of somebody said something to you last week. And what's going on? It's all waswasa, shayateen attacking you. And one of the scholars said, if you could see this unseen reality or these shayateen attaching themselves to people and causing them to become demonic forces out there, active. He said, if you could see what's happening, some people, as soon as you see them, you'd run away the other side. And just constantly you'd be saying, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself used to daily make adhkar seeking protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أعوذ بكلمات الله التامات من شر ما خلق. بسم الله الذي لا يضر مع اسمه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء وهو السميع العليم. Daily, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was, even people did some things to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but Allah protected him. But the reality is, there's always going to be pushback from jinn and from the ins. And so what are you supposed to do? Seek protection in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you feel this pushback, and you see this people trying to put obstacles in your path, trying to block you from worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, trying to create mischief and problems, trying to get your mind away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remember, this is a test for you and for them. Fitna is part of this creation. You know, if dunya was meant to be Jannah, it would be all peaceful. But it's not meant to be Jannah. So you're going to have these problems. And there will be people in your life, closest people to you, people you love, they'll give you the hardest time. They'll give you the hardest time. So the scholars just said, number one, don't expect anything from anyone. Why not? Because Allah created us, He gave us life, He gave us everything we can imagine, and we're falling short in fulfilling our responsibilities to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You think because your children or your wife or your husband, this and that, you did this to them, and so are they going to live up to your expectations? Forget it. People, they're disobeying their Lord. Forget about them doing what's good for you. Don't expect anything from anyone. And as long as you keep that in mind, you'll never be disappointed with people. Number two, they said that, you know, don't ask for people what's due to you. If some people owe you something, people are indebted to you, don't go and demand your rights. Don't even forget about even your rights. Because, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has made it clear, human being, they're going to fall short and fall short and fall short. And so many a times, if you feel like you're being cheated out of your rights, and asking so can create all these extra fitnas, just save yourself the trouble. Save yourself the trouble. Don't get involved. Another thing, shayateen, they love to plot. Shayateen, when they get inside people, they become master politicians. They'll sit at night, they're making plots and everything. And so you'll find politics in workplaces, you'll find politics in families, you'll find politics in the way you deal with your in-laws, you'll find politics in the, you know, in the best places, in the worst places, in the masajid, in the governments. And every time you see these things happening, no, shaitan is involved. And keep your heart clean, because if you get involved in their politics, your heart is going to die. You're going to kill your heart. And you're going to kill your intentions. And so keep your heart clean and keep your heart always turning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the only way to survive in these environments. And Dawood alayhi salam, the king, who was in charge of running an entire government, he had the biggest responsibility. Every single night he used to retire to his house and he used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in solitude. If you're involved in all of these fitan, you need some alone time with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And do yourself the favor and give yourself some of this alone time. So that you can come back to your senses. Otherwise, this fitna, it comes, it's like fire. It burns you up from the inside. And what happens, next thing you know, you're burning up everything around you. You can destroy your family. You can destroy your livelihood. You can destroy everything. Because you don't know how to calm down. And so, give yourself some time alone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as long as you turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything's going to be okay. So trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We conclude with this. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower us with His mercy. Forgive us our sins, the major ones, the minor ones. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the courage to see the positive in everything. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from pessimism and from negativity. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, we ask You, anyone going through the difficulties, Ya Allah, we ask You, Ya Allah, grant us ease, Ya Allah, and grant us sakina, Ya Allah, and grant us peace and tranquility into our hearts, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, we ask You, anyone seeking anything, Ya Allah, we ask You to grant us contentment, Ya Allah. And whatever is good for us, Ya Allah, grant us that, Ya Allah. Whatever is harmful for us, Ya Allah, take it away from us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, all the Muslims suffering in the world, Ya Allah, due to calamities, due to oppression, due to whatever it is, Ya Allah, we ask You, Ya Allah, grant them patience, Ya Allah. Keep their feet firm in deen, Ya Allah. And don't let them stray from Your remembrance, Ya Allah. And make their last words, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, we ask You to establish the muttaqeen in the land, Ya Allah. And grant them tamkeen, Ya Allah. And we ask You, Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, to debase and bring low the oppressors, Ya Allah, and the shayateen, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, anyone going through difficulties in their families, unite our hearts, Ya Allah. Anyone going through difficulties in their health, Ya Allah, grant us shifa, Ya Allah. Anyone going through difficulties in their livelihood, provide for us halal and tayyib rizq, Ya Allah. Don't make us dependent on anyone other than You, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, we ask You to pay off our debts, Ya Allah. Free us from the slavery of interest and riba, Ya Allah. And Ya Allah, we ask You, and unite us under the shade of Your throne, Ya Allah. And enter us into Jannah hand in hand, Ya Allah. Anyone that have lost any loved one among them, Ya Allah, we ask You to have mercy on them, Ya Allah. And we ask You to elevate them to high level, Ya Allah. And make their graves pieces of Jannah, Ya Allah. Anyone going through difficulties, about to go through operations or anything of that nature, Ya Allah, we ask You to grant them success, Ya Allah. In dunya and akhirah. Wa sallallahu alayhi sayyidina Muhammad wa alayhi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wa akhira da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Aqimus salam.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.